Good morning, Uplift Church. That is one of my all-time favorite songs, The Grass is Greener on the Other Side. And I love that song, and I pray it just continues to speak with you. It's a few Easters ago we done that song live here, and I don't know, I just absolutely love that song. Because I think it's something we all can relate to. We always look at something, and it seems like the grass is greener on the other side. If I only had that, or if I was just over there, or if we were just to that spot, or if we could just get to that spot with our family, it would... Man, it'd be so much better. But wherever Jesus is, that is where the grass is greener. And that's the message of the entire psalm. Merry Christmas. I'm going to have you stand to your feet. We're going to go around. I encourage you to take this time. Tell somebody Merry Christmas. It is a beautiful time. We're celebrating Christmas. We're in a full swing. Tell somebody Merry Christmas. If you don't know who they are, introduce who you are. Tell them who you are. We want to say good morning. And Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, Mom and Dad. I love you, sis. Thank you, baby. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, buddy. Great, man. You? Good. Merry Christmas, girls. You gonna give me five? Give me five. Merry Christmas to you. So good to see you guys. We've been taking this time as an opportunity just to go around and say hello and just to kind of be friendly. And sometimes on Sunday morning, I mean, if you're like the Johnson house, sometimes it seems like you're coming in on two wheels. And there's been times that I've come with two pairs of shoes on. And sometimes our kids have done the same thing too. And so sometimes it's fun just to take a minute, pause and breathe and say, in this case, Merry Christmas. I started looking at that phrase, Merry Christmas, because it's a phrase that we don't really say unless it's Christmas time. Well, looking back and researching through that, it wasn't until like the 1500s that the phrase was even kind of started put together. And that's when, during the same time that December 25th was kind of set aside as the day that we worship, or a day we remember, not worship that day, but we remember, recognize the birth of Jesus. And then the phrase still didn't get really used until in the 1800s when Charles Dickens wrote Christmas Carol. And in that, if you've ever watched a Christmas Carol, there's so many different renditions of it, there's the phrase, Merry Christmas. And thus it's been used. And over through the years, it's kind of had different types of meaning and phrases. But what really hit me is that last night I went to Pizza Plus and picked up some pizza, and I went through the drive-thru, and I told her, I was like, hey, we got the four large pizzas. She said, okay. She came back, and I said, Merry Christmas. And the lady, she just instantly just smiled and said, Merry Christmas. Like, whenever I say that, I've never had one person say, bah humbug. Have you? I never have. You can go, it doesn't matter where you're at, whether you're at Lowe's and amongst some of the most manliest men. And this happened to us on Friday. I was in Lowe's, and it was just somebody, and I don't know why, it just came out of him. It's just Merry Christmas. It was a kind of burly man, if you understand what I'm saying. This was a manly man. And first I thought, well, I don't know how he's going to take this, but I just didn't even think. I just blurted out, Merry Christmas. And you know what he said back to me? Merry Christmas. And he kept right on walking. I'm sure he had that man thought, I'm going to go get what I'm going to go get. But he did say, Merry Christmas. Not by humbug. Merry Christmas is like one of the most simple things that we can do to share this joy that we have. And that's what Merry is all about. It's about sharing, being merry, sharing merriness. And it's joy. It is It is joy. And this is why it is so important that we don't just get through the holidays, but we have something to be joyous about. Church, that is why, as today we come to the conclusion of Revelation 22, I think it is so powerful and so fitting, because we're coming full circle to God's plan. Full circle to God's plan. We know that the birth of Jesus is what really set it into motion, but we know that in Genesis is when it really got started. And so in Revelation 22, what God does, and I love this when movies do this, he just wraps a bow on and goes, there you go. It's a complete story. I despise anything that says to be continued. Do you? I despise it. Because the whole time you're there waiting, you're like, now you got to wait, you know, another year for it to be coming out. And Christmas time, there's a lot about Harry Potter, and they would tie it in a little bow, but then they'd leave little tidbits for the next, or whatever series that it is, if you watch a TV series. And I remember we would do this growing up, and then they would have like a season finale, and then they would have these to be continued with those three dots. And we're like, now we got to wait, you know, till next fall, and then pick back up on it. Well, God doesn't do to be continued. He gives you the entire story. And this is what today is so powerful about, because we have the greatest message, the greatest hope this world ever has. So we have more reason to be joyous than anybody else. Joyous. Do you have joy today? Are you experiencing a Merry Christmas? Now, there's many things that can hinder that, but the only way for us not to have joy, the only way for us not to experience joy, is by our choosing. Last week, we kind of summed up Revelation 21, in which John wrote what he saw, this new heaven, this new earth, and what God has presented to us. He gave us this vision. He gave us the layout of this new Jerusalem, what it looks like, our forever home. And then in Revelation 22, he sums it up. So you have your Bibles, turn with us in Revelation 22. And this is, I say it's so powerful because we have joy. And this is why with this come to circle, dear Christmas time, I think it really comes to light. And so the timing of this entire series, and we've been going through this chapter by chapter, beginning with Revelation chapter 1, it comes full circle because God is perfect. Even when the Bible was put together, it's perfect. Revelation chapter 22, verse 1, he says this. This is John now. He says, then he showed me the river of living water, sparkling like crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, down the middle of the broad street of the city. The tree of life was on both sides of the river, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. And there will no longer be any curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be in the city, and his slaves will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. Night will no longer exist, and people will not need lamplight or sunlight, because the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. This is a scene of this new Jerusalem, our forever home. But there's something in this river. And I can't really draw a throne, so the only way I know that it looks like goalpost. Okay, I don't really know how this throne looks like, and I just know that it's beautiful in the way that it's arranged. So this is, say, the throne of God. But it says that out of this is flowing this river of life, and it's flowing out of here, this river of life. And what this is to us is the sustainability. This is a window, a picture of everlasting life. On both sides of this river, we have trees. This tree of life, it's here on both sides. And it says there's 12 kinds of fruit that bear on this tree. There's my fruit, okay? But 12 different kinds. And I know that my picture is not very good, but this is this river of life, and we've got these trees on both sides of this. The tree of life was on both sides of the river, bearing 12 kinds of fruit. But here's what I found amazing about it. It produced fruit every month. Every month. Every month. But we said this is everlasting life. Okay, so when we say everlasting life, So there's a few words that I say stand out. Everlasting life is one of them, that, and it stands out to me, everlasting life. But he also said there's not going to be any day, but there's going to be this light. He's going to be the light. So there's not going to be, we're not going to need a lamp. So there's going to have this constant light that he is. So then how in the world can he say every month it produces? I don't have all the answers to God's word and what he's saying here, but there's going to be some sense of time, because time will be measured in the presence of God. He is the light. He is the time. It's all in him. So everything that we experience through him not only brings us in a closer relationship to him, but we get to have an intimate relationship with him. Don't you feel closer to God than others? We do. I do. There's times it feels like that I'm so walking so close with him, sometimes it feels like he's right beside him. Then other times it seems like, man, he's so far away. This scene that he's painting here for us shows us, church, that in this forever home that we're going to experience, in this new Jerusalem, we will have a close, intimate fellowship, relationship with God, where there's no distance. Be that close. How can that be? I'm glad you asked, because verse 3 answers it for us. There's something that's absent in this. Did you catch it in verse 3, what he says? Look at what he says here. It's in verse 3. He says, there will no longer be any curse. Sin is gone. So it's hard for us to wrap our minds around this. How can you have a tree that produces every month? How can you have a river of life flowing out of the throne of God and the Lamb? How can that be? Well, there's not going to be any curse. Sin is gone. It's abolished. So we're going to live in paradise. This perfect place and perfect fellowship with God, with God's perfected people. And there's not going to be anything to hinder it. That's what we discussed last week. And he emphasizes it in chapter 22. No curse. Perfect. With this perfect place and this perfect city that we're going to be in. And I love this in the last part of verse 5. He says, and they will reign forever and ever. This is it. Forever home. Forever and ever we will be in this everlasting life in God's presence. Now, what is so cool about this is that the difference of this is, the difference of the way that we measure time and light is based upon the sun. The way it's going to be measured there is because of Jesus. Oh, it's going to be so cool. So cool. Now, this other thing that this part, it's a part of a picture for us here. We can see it resembles a lot. And if you read in Genesis, we got the Garden of Eden. We've got the Garden of Eden. And what is so cool about this is what some people refer to as the New Eden. There's so many things. There's a tree of life. There's a river in the Garden of Eden. And remember, man was cast out of it because they could not eat of the tree of life and live forever with the curse. So that was the whole reason why God, C-U-R-S, that doesn't look right, but I think it is, curse. We could not live forever in sin. This is God's whole plan, why he sent his son, to deliver us from what? The curse. We've got sin that's in us. So you can put curse and you can put slash sin, but that was when the curse came upon the land. And so we've got this perfect place that we're going to be living in. Perfect. In church, it's hard for us to imagine a perfect place. Do you know why? Because there's no perfect house. Something's going to break. There's no perfect car because it will get old. If you have kids, well, you know what's going to happen to it. There's no perfect land because we've got thorns, thistles. There's no perfect people because we've got sin. So it's hard for us to wrap our minds around this perfected place, but that's where we're going to be. And that's why Revelation 21, we have this something that we can long for. And what he does in these first 6 verses, what he's painting this picture for us is, well, look, then he said to me, verse 6, then he said to me, these words are faithful and true, and the Lord, the God, the Spirit of the prophets, has sent his angel to show his slaves what must quickly take place. Look, I'm coming quickly. The one who keeps the prophetic words of this book are blessed. This is why we can have joy. We are to keep the words. We learned this in Revelation chapter 1, that he said anybody who studies this book will be blessed. Blessed. Now, and I said then, and I will reiterate that right now, I want all of God's blessings. I want all I can get. God just put a spiritual funnel over me and give me all I can take. And let the overflow come out. I want all of God's blessings. And he says, you're going to be blessed just by studying this book. But he says something different in this part. Not only are the one who stays, it's the one who keeps the prophetic words of this book. So the first of a part of it in chapter 1, we're talking about the study of it, that we would take it. Now he's saying, keep it. So how do we keep God's word? We live it. See, God's Spirit lives in us, and we keep it by the way that we live. We live it. And many of us are going through life right now, and we're saying this very same thing, I can't live it. We give up, we quit, we'll stop living close to Him. I can't live it. There's many things in our lives that we quit on, we'll give up on. The first turkey that I ever made was terrible. The first biscuits that my wife made, and gravy. The biscuits were hard as rocks, and the gravy was like toothpaste. I did not say a word. I was eating it anyway. And then she said, you don't have to eat that. But I didn't say a word. But you know what? She didn't give up. And now, man, it's really good. It's really good. Church, that's the way it is when we walk with God. We're not always going to get it right, but we're going to get a little closer. We're never going to get it right here. We're never going to be able to walk in perfect harmony because of the sin that is filled here. But what he's saying is that sin's gone. So now we can walk perfectly with him. So keep the words of his book. Keep these prophetic words. Walk with him. Learn. Grow. Well, the beginning of in Revelation, we saw this through the first three chapters, is that Jesus gave this revelation to John. And in each one, he wrote these letters to these seven churches. And in each one, Jesus described himself. And here he describes himself as faithful and true. Again, faithful and true. These are the words. Keep them. Church, you need God's word in your life. You need God's word in your life. I tell everyone they need a power verse. I think it's very powerful. A verse that is your go-to. That when something happens in your life, that there's a verse that's a part of you that you immediately turn to, that can already fix your eyes on Jesus instead of the problem. Because anytime we focus on the problem, it amplifies. When we focus on Jesus, the problem comes a lot. We focus on Him. We need a power verse. You need somebody in the Bible that you can connect with, somebody that you can relate to, that you can study and learn about them, so you can see how they navigated through life, and so that it'll help you navigate through life. We need God's Word. If you haven't picked one of these up, then please do before you leave, one of our daily breads. Get God's Word in you. Get God's Word in you. But there's a phrase in here that he says, quickly. Quickly. My version of quickly and God's version of quickly are two completely different quicklies. Parents, how many times do you ever have to tell your kids, hurry up, hurry up, clean your room, come on, let's go. Teachers, you do the same thing to students, all right, come on, let's. I don't know why I'm doing it. I had a teacher that had a ruler she always carried with. She'd done that, and I think that's why I'm doing it. She'd always... I said if I became a teacher, I would not have a ruler, but I'm doing the same thing with my... So, hurry up. Come on. Hurry up. Quickly. Quickly now. And sometimes I think we struggle with that same thing too with God. I do with God. Sometimes I'm praying. I'm like, God, I need you to move in this in a mighty way. Okay. Anytime, God. I'm waiting. Behold, I come quickly. Church, John wrote this somewhere around 96 AD. And he says, I'm coming quickly. And he wrote it in 96 AD. I'm coming quickly. See, God has a time in his perfect choosing. See, we got everlasting life. That's what's the future, what's ahead of us. So then why in the world is he still dragging his feet? I'm so glad you asked, because he's not dragging his feet. He's got a perfect plan. Look at this in verse 8. Here's a part of his plan. Verse 8, he says, I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I heard them and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had shown them to me. But he said to me, don't do that. I'm a fellow slave with you. Your brothers, the prophets, and those who keep the words of this book, worship God. And he also said to me, don't steal the prophetic words of this book, because the time is near. Let unrighteous go on in unrighteousness. Let the filthy go on being made filthy. Let the righteous go on in unrighteousness. And let the holy go being made holy. There's a call in this book for three things in these three verses. One, John realized that, wait a minute, this revelation has been revealed to me. I am not worthy. He began to bow down and to worship this messenger. And the messenger's like, wait a minute, no. You're to worship God. All attention and focus should be on him. And that's what those three letters in Revelation chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3 are pointing to. It's all about him. It's all about him. We are to worship him. Worship should be a part of our bodies, our life, not just something on Sundays, but a livelihood, become a part of us in which we worship. I don't know if you've ever gone down the road. You're driving, and it's just like you have a moment with God, and you're worshiping in your car. And sometimes you may have the radio on, sometimes you don't. And I've caught myself in this, whether I be at a red light or whatever, and I don't know, man, I'm just worshiping. I don't know what anybody else is doing, but it's just me and God in that car. Worship God. Let it be a daily part of your life. Worship God. We worship God through getting his word in us, reading his word, praying is a way that we can worship God. We can sing to God, yes, pray, sing unto him. But he's saying we need to worship God. There's things during our weeks and in our time frame that we'll often put above God. And he said, no. The focus is on God. Nothing else. The focus is on God. In your life, that needs to be the primary focus, but there's a second. He says, don't steal these prophetic words of this book, because the time is near. Don't steal it. We are to share it. And that's why I love Christmas time. Merry Christmas! We get to share the joyous news that God sent his son. Merry Christmas! We get to share that part. We have the great part of being joyous about something. I wonder how many people celebrate Christmas and have no idea what they're doing. We have a tree, but what does it mean? We have candy canes, we have lights, we have a star, but what does it all mean? Yeah, we'll buy gifts for everybody, but what does it mean? Yeah, we'll go get a good deal on a gift and disregard how we treat salespeople and other shoppers because we want the perfect gift to give to somebody, but if we're not merry, then what's the use? Sometimes we're going around and we're the ones who's saying bah humbug by our personalities and what we're sharing. Church, it should not be. And the reason why this resonates so much with me is when me and Amanda first got married, there were these Tickle Me Elmos that were so popular. So popular. And I remember on me and Amanda, we went shopping on Black Friday, and I was at Walmart, and I was going, and I saw it. I was walking towards it. And I grabbed it at the same time somebody else grabbed it, who kicked me in the shin and got it. Does that not seem like something you'd read in the story or real life experience right here? And I told a man, I said, I'm done. We ought to be merry and share the... It should be so much a part of our lives that it just exhumes our body. Be such a part of your life, such a part of who you are, that people can look at you and they can see Jesus. They can look at you and go, wow, that guy's merry. Yes, I'm merry because I've got something to be merry about. I don't have to walk around by humbug. We've got everlasting life. Yes, be merry. Now, there's times that I don't feel like being merry. and you don't either. So we don't have to be fake about it. But we do have a reason to be merry. We do have a reason to be joyous. And he's saying, we're to share. Because this message is being given to everybody for this one word. Because this is what he's saying in that last part of that verse that we read. We have something that is called free will, that you can choose how you want to live your life. You can choose whether or not you want to accept Jesus. You can choose whether or not you're going to wake up each morning grateful and thankful and joyous. Or if you want to be a Scrooge, you have that choice. You have free will. You are not a programmed robot. You can make that choice. But we have been given the opportunity to be merry and to share what God has given us. Church, life is hard. There's times about it that it is not very joyous. So then how do we live? How is it that we can go through life, through all these experiences, and be joyous? How can we do this? Well, church, I think it's a part of it by we do what he said in these first voices. We're the first verses that we're looking to God. We're worshiping him. See, if we make that a priority, number one, okay? He's saying that's worship God. That's what the angel said. He said, wait a minute, don't you do that. Worship God. So if we will focus on that first and foremost, worship God, I think it'll help you being merry. It'll help you being merry. Now, there were several years I struggled during Thanksgiving and Christmas about being merry. I really struggled. In 2007, it was on November the 18th, we came home from church on a Sunday, and I was outside with the dog, and Amanda came outside on the porch, and she said my name, and I knew something was wrong. And all she said was, "It's Kevin." Kevin Jones was one of my life mentors. He invested in me. I loved him. I loved his mama, his dad. Loved his dog, Braxton. And on November the 18th, he took his life. He loved Christmas. So there's a period of several years there that I really struggled being merry at that time. Because I didn't understand. I was hurt. And it still hurts. So there's times as we go through life, there's going to be some hurt. There's going to be some things that we don't want to experience or go through. There's going to be things that your kids, you don't want them to experience or go through. And as a parent, if you could, you would take their place. But we got to remember. Right now we're living in this cursed, sin-filled world. But there's coming a day in Revelation chapter 21 when he says that he'll wipe away every tear. No more pain, no more death, no more sorrow. So how do we get to God? How do we walk with him? How do we be merry even when we don't feel like it? I think it's when we focus on worshiping God. And there's a second part of this that he said. He said, let them go on. So the second thing that we do, so we worship God. But the second thing is, we share. Church, you have something very powerful within you. Very powerful within you. We share. We be merry. We've got something very powerful within us, the Holy Spirit. Share it. Live it. Live it. You may be the only Bible anybody ever reads. You are that powerful. When me and Amanda got married, we lived in Tennessee, so we had Tennessee insurance. When we moved back to Virginia, we were switching back to Virginia insurance. And so we had to get a Virginia representative. And so I called up who we had insurance through when I was 16, and I was saying, hey, me and my wife are getting renter's insurance. We're renting over in Dean Holler in Nicholsville. We got two cars, and we need to get insurance. and she was anything but Mary. It felt like that I was troubling her by bringing business to them. There was nothing joyous. And I said, you know what? Just don't worry about it. So I called another place down the road and I said, hey, we're moving back to Virginia. We need to get insurance. And you know what they said? Oh, that's great. Yeah, we'd love to have you. That'd be great. And so guess who we got insurance with now? The people that were married. But do you see how it's contagious, how that catches on? We can share that. The way you do your job, the way you lead your family, the way you go to a ball game. There's some people at a ball game that I would love to sit beside. Now, there's other ones that they get a little extreme for me. I'd rather sit away from them. But if you're one of those moms, or that, go for it. We've got to be merry. Be merry. Share. We've got something to be so joyous about. Be joyous. Be joyous. So how do we do this? We worship God in church. We share. This is the same principle that told us there's two things that we need to focus on. Love God and love others. Love God and love others. I love this. Look at verse 16. He says, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to attest these things to you for the churches. I am the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star. Both the Spirit and the bride say, come. Anyone hears should say, come. And the one who is thirsty should come. Whoever desires should take the living water as a gift. Here's the response. See, the reason why many of us are not merry, the reason many of us don't share, I'm going to put share / merry. It's because there's an underlying part of here, so when we do this, there's an equals. I'm going to put a question mark there. When you buy somebody a gift, you typically try to buy something that's targeted towards them. Sometimes you may even ask what they want. And when you give it to them, you're almost expected a certain response. Many times, I have gotten something for Amanda, and she didn't quite have the response that I thought she ought to have. I remember buying flowers, and her saying, those are nice, and that was it. I watered them. I did. And in my mind, I said, it's the last time you're getting flowers. You know how that went, right? Well, it didn't go well. Because I had preconceived in my mind, she's going to love this. We're going to put rose petals up the stairwell. It's going to be great. Church, it was none of that. Ah, those are nice. Thank you. It was flowers and a nice bow. This wasn't a Food City $12.99. This was a nice floral arrangement. Like, I went all out. Those are nice. Church, we do the same thing. When we go and give somebody a gift and you've done it too, you're like, you're just waiting for that reaction. And then when you don't get it, you're like, I messed up. And sometimes you'll run somewhere else and you go, hey, I had another part to your gift. Here it is. You've done it. Because we had the idea they're going to have a certain reaction, this equal sign. But he says, no, let whoever come take of it freely. Receive this gift freely. We cannot help how others respond to our merriness. Our merriness. We cannot. We cannot help how somebody responds to whether it be a gift that they get, or true, the way that they leave your presence when you're at work, we can't help. But we can help our presence and the way that we share it. And that's why he says on this, let them take so freely. It's a free gift. Let them take it. All he's asking us to do is worship him and share. Worship him and share. Worship him and be merry. Be merry. And sometimes it'll surprise you. It will surprise you how people will react. Church, this is the same thing that Jesus had with the conversation with the woman at the well. You can read about that in John chapter 4. But he was saying, hey, I'll give you the water that you'll never thirst again. Never thirst again. You can take of it freely. Church, we are to share. And one of the greatest ways we can share right now is through Merry Christmas. I'm not saying you have to buy everybody a gift. But church, you can be merry. You've got something to be merry about. We have everlasting life. And this news, this hope of Jesus, is shared for everyone. And church, there's so many things that will rob us of our joy, but only if you let it. Yeah, there's sad times. And yes, sometimes during Christmas, it does get hard. Things are a little different. Sometimes we get scared because we're afraid that we're going to mess up. Look at verse 18. He says, I testify to everyone who hears the prophetic words of this book. If anyone adds to them, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of this prophetic book, God will take away his share of the tree of life and the holy city written in the book. See, sometimes we're afraid right here because we don't know the outcome. You know, we don't know what it's going to look like. But he gives us, here's the only thing you've got to worry about. This is it. Don't add to it, and don't take away. Just share what's in there. That's it. Just share what's in the Bible. If you share God's love, you'll never go wrong. Who's like, I would like you know, invite people to church. I just don't know how they're going to react. Neither do I. I have no idea. But it's just like telling somebody Merry Christmas. I've yet to have somebody say Bah Humbug. I invite people to church, and usually they'll beat around the bush. Sometimes I get a yes. Sometimes I get a no. Okay. But I've yet had anybody be angry or mad at me for inviting them to church. It's the same thing. Have you ever had someone be upset with you when you said, I'll pray for you? I've never had somebody go, oh, no, don't do that. No, please don't pray. Never. They've always said, thank you. It didn't matter how far they were from God. They would always say, thank you. Thank you. So we don't need to worry about the equal sign. Leave all the results up to God. He can take care of that. We're just supposed to share and be merry. And when we do that, okay, sometimes, yeah, we might mess up. We might fumble our words. But he says, listen, don't add to and don't take away. That's it. Don't add to and don't take away. So when the Bible says something, you can speak on that. Church, this gives us the freedom that we can invite and share and be married to anybody we want to. It does not matter. Be merry. Be merry. And if somebody doesn't like your merriness, it's not your problem. It is theirs. See, we got it figured out. So be merry. Be merry. And the times when you're not merry, the times when you're coming into church on sideways or you finally got to work and you're a mess and you spilled your coffee on you, you know what? We can be merry anyway because we've got something to be merry about. Church, are you merry? Are you merry? You should be merry. We should be so merry. Church, it's time for us to share this joy that God has given us. Share this joy to be merry. My question to you is, can you share the joy of Christ? Can you share that? That's what Christmas is all about. We say it's about Jesus' birth. It's not about the Black Friday deals, and it's not about saving money here. It's about sharing this joy of Jesus. Share it. Share it. Can you share that joy? It's on you. Can you do it? I think you can. I think we can. This pure joy. Can you imagine what would happen if people looked at you and they could see the joy in you? I'll never forget it happened to me. The day after I gave my life to Christ, the very next day when I went to work, my coworker who we worked side by side with, he looked at me and he said, what's wrong with you? That's what he said. Like, man, I don't really know what happened last night. I don't know if I got saved. However you want to say it, get right with God. All I know is I'm good with God and he's good with me. And he said, well, I don't understand. It's like, me neither. Me neither, but you ought to come to church with me. We'll figure it out together. That's kind of the way that I went about it. Could you imagine what happened if people see the joy in you? Joy in you. Church, that is the part that should be contagious about Jesus. It just shares. It's just that infectious. We just share it out. When people see you, they see Jesus. When they see you, they see him. Oh, yeah, and there's times that we don't always get it right, and there's times that we're closer with him than others. That's why it's so important that we go back to number one, worship God. Worship God. Worship God. Church, if we do this, it's not going to impact your life. It's going to impact everybody around you. Because when you're joyous, it can't help but get on everybody else. It's like you're sneezing joy. It's just like, I could probably come with a better analogy, but it's just that infectious. We're just sharing it. It's Jesus. It's joyous, and it's all over us, and we can't help but share because we got something to be so joyous about. Be joyous. Be joyous. Could you imagine what could happen in your life, in your family, about being joyous, about wishing a Merry Christmas and meaning it. And meaning it. Do you see the power in that? God is so, so good to us. And there's an urgency, church, to share the joy. I don't know about you, but I've got friends and family who need the joy of Jesus in their heart. We often say that they're a good person, they just need Jesus. Well, if you look through our Revelation study, you're either a sinner going to hell or you're a saved sinner going to heaven. There is no in between. And I have people in my life that I love dearly, and they need Jesus. I don't want you to raise your hand, but I want to ask you, do you have people in your life that need Jesus? Do you? Church, could you imagine if they see Jesus in you? What if your family, what if the person who's number one in your heart that needs Jesus, what if they see Jesus in me? In me? That's how powerful it is that we share the message of Jesus, that we be Mary. And the urgency is here. Well, he says this, and there's three verses that I want to share with you as we come to a close. And he says this because he says, look, I'm coming quickly. He says this same phrase in verse 7, 12, and 20. I put them all there together. 7, 12, and 20. He says the exact same phrase. I'm coming quickly. I'm coming quickly. I'm coming quickly. And we're looking back through time and thinking, okay, John wrote this in like 97 A.D. Where's the quickness at? Well, it goes back to us praying and say, okay, God, I need something now. God is not moved by your expiration date. God, I need you to move by Friday. I don't think that moves him. God moves when his people worship him and share him. I think that moves God. Behold, I'm coming quickly. Look, I'm coming quickly. I love what he says here. Look, I'm coming quickly. The one who keeps the prophetic words of this book is blessed. Verse 12, look, I'm coming quickly. My reward is with me to repay each person according to what he has done. Verse 20, he who testifies about these things, testifying, sharing, being merry, yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Verse 20 comes with a prayer at the end of it. Come, Lord Jesus. I am ready. It reminds me, if you've ever seen the movie, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? He goes in and he gets in the water and he gets baptized. And he says, come on in, boys. The water is fine. That's what he's saying to her. Come on in. Come, Lord Jesus. I am ready. I'm being joyous. I'm being merry. I have no reason to fret your coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Come. We have a call and an urgency to share and to put it back to the Christmas, to be merry. Are you merry? Is there something in your life right now that's keeping you from being merry? Because here's the time for you to respond. We all have things that come up. We all have challenges. I told you of something very personal in my life that, say, beginning with November the 18th through Christmas, I really struggled with. I'm having a hard time with it this year. Because in the spring, my friend Kevin, his mom that I was really close to, and I always checked on her. So she passed away this past year. Her son loved Christmas. It's something, a common bond that we shared. We was able to talk and to share about that. In a very short time period, she lost her son. She lost her son's dog. She lost her husband. She had so many things about her that she should not be merry. But yet, she was merry. Church, may that be an inspiration to you. When we worship God, when we focus on Him, it'll set our eyes to look at what really matters. To look at what's before us right now. Your friends, your family, your livelihood that you're living right now. We have no reason not to be merry. Church, I want you to be able to leave here today, not only to be able to wish people a Merry Christmas, but to be of such of a clean heart and a pure mind that you mean it. This morning, are you merry? Are you going to walk out of here today being merry? Because we have something to be merry about. Church, if there is something that is keeping you from being merry, maybe it's something that you need to forgive. Maybe it's hard for you during Christmas time because you've got certain family that, man, you just, it's complicated. And maybe you need to pray about that situation. Maybe you need to give them to Jesus. Maybe you need to give yourself to Jesus. Is there something in your life that's keeping you from having this joy, that's keeping you from being merry? Church, I encourage you to, whatever that is, whatever that situation or whatever that person, we give that to Jesus. And we leave here being merry because we have something to be merry about. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you so much for your word and how you've spoken so clear to us today, Father. And we have got a clear reason, Father, to be joyful, to be merry. God, I pray today, Father, that we would leave here having a better understanding not only of who you are and what you want done, but God, that we would walk in the newness of your life. We have everlasting life that is waiting for us. And here, Father, we have been challenged to be merry. God, that we would worship God and be merry, that we would share Jesus. And Father, we can do that. We can do that in our families. We can do that at work. God, just by being joyous. Help us, Father, right now to the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, would you speak right now? Father, through the power and presence of your Holy Spirit right now, I pray that you would search this room. Fill us up, God, that we may be merry. Church, as you continue to pray, nobody's looking around. This is time for you and God time right now. Church, is there something in your life that is keeping you from the joy of Jesus, that's keeping you from being merry? Right now, would you give that situation? Would you give it to Him? Give that to Him. I'm not asking anyone to raise your hand. I just want you to talk to the Father. If there's a situation or a person in your life keeping you from being merry, I'm just asking you, church, to give that to Him right now. Because we want you to leave here today being merry. Being merry. I'm going to give you some more time just to talk to the Father. What's going on in your life? Maybe it's not a person. Maybe it's not a thing. Maybe you're just something that you're struggling with this morning. Church, give that to Him. Be merry. Be merry. Church, if there's something heavy on your heart, I encourage you, if you need to come to the altar this morning, would you come? Church, if you want someone to pray with you, I'd love to have the opportunity. I'll cut my mic off and I'll pray for you. If there's something heavy on your heart, heavy, something you need to bring His presence, you bring it? It's time for us to be merry. you continue to pray for somebody else, if you're something heavy on your heart, you need to come and pray. We want you to walk away here today being merry. Being merry. Maybe there's some of you here today that maybe your heart is clear, but maybe there's just something that you just need prayer for, whatever that may be. For this, I am going to ask you to raise your hand. There's something going on in your life. Wow, there's hands already going up. Yeah. Yeah, let's pray together. Will there be others? Hey, we got something going on in our life, a situation. I need God's guidance. Just pray for me. Let's pray together, church. Father, you see these hands. Man, there's so many just went up immediately. Father, I think you're speaking to your people. And God, I pray right now for clarity, Father, that you would lead them and help them, Father, with what's up on their hearts. God, help them, Father, that nothing would rob us from the joy that you have placed in us, Jesus. Help them, Father, that not only would they be merry, but help them, Father, as they go through these next few weeks. God, that when people see them, they could see Jesus. Help them, Father, to make wise decisions and to follow you, God, in all that they say and all that they do. And God, I pray more than anything, as we go through our life, when people look at us, they see Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Would you take a moment, give God some praise? God, you're so very awesome.